Great morning, everybody. It gives me an immense pleasure to meet you all in this new day. We are all here for a really informative and an interesting session of the seminar on the topic Testing Statistical Hypothesis and Algebraic Graph Theory. God fulfills our desire if we call up to Him and acknowledge Him every time, particularly at the beginning of the work. So let us all invoke the presence of God with a prayer song.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the
nothing else can lighten an event except a delightful warm welcome. So I now request our esteemed head of the department, Dr. Arul Flower Mary, to introduce the chief guest and welcome the gathering.
Good morning to all. At the outset, I extend my warm welcome to our loving principal, Dr. Sister Sophie. Her sincerity, hard work, perfectionism, and simplicity leads our college towards its vision and mission. On behalf of myself, the mathematics faculty and students, I extend a very cordial welcome to her. Next, it is my pleasant duty to introduce and welcome the resource person of session one, Dr. S. Suresh. It is not an exaggeration if we describe him as an young Indian talent. Currently, he is working as assistant professor of statistics in Madras University, Chennai. He is an alumni of the statistics department, MS University, Tirunelveli, and won the gold medal for being the topper in the PG program. He pursued his PhD program also in MS University and received the UGC BSRF award during his PhD program. He has also won the prestigious DST Inspire award for pursuing quality research from the Department of Science and Technology, New Delhi. He has 8 publications in international journals and 4 in international conference proceedings. He has 2 ongoing projects, one sponsored by DST PERS program phase 2 worth rupees 2 lakhs and another sponsored by RUSA 2.0 worth rupees 34 lakhs. He is a life member of the International Statistics Association and the Indian Society for Probability and Statistics. He has rich knowledge in various computer softwares like SPSS, MATLAB, etc. Dr. Suresh and myself did our PhD program under the same guide in MS University. I take this opportunity to thank him most sincerely for the immense help he extended to me during my 2.5 years in the university as a full-time research scholar. I have full confidence in the fact that Dr. Suresh will reach great heights and achieve great things in his career and professional life. I wish him all the very best in the years to come. Once more, I extend a very warm welcome to you, Dr. Suresh.
Thank you. Ma'am, shall I start now?
Next, I welcome all my dear colleagues whose cooperation boosts up my career life. Last but not the least, I welcome all my enthusiastic, young and cheerful students and other participants and wish you a very useful time ahead. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Now, our principal, Dr. Sister Annie Puppet Sophie, will felicitate and deliver her felicitation address.
Respected resource persons of today's seminar, Dr. Suresh, Dr. Radhasekhar, faculty, research scholars, and students of other institutions, may have joined to online mode. Faculty and students of our own institution, a pleasant good morning to each one of you. Today is a significant day for the PG and Research Department of Mathematics that hosts this seminar on testing statistical hypothesis and algebraic graph theory. It's a relevant topic for the present time for both learners and researchers. Testing statistical hypothesis is a method of statistical inference used to decide whether the data at hand is sufficiently supports a particular hypothesis. It is one of the most important processes for measuring the validity and reliability of outcomes in any systematic investigation. Algebraic graph theory, as you all know, is a branch of mathematics in which the algebraic methods are applied to problems about graphs, which is in contrast to the geometric, combinatoric, and algorithmic approaches. This seminar has been organized to highlight on the different aspects of these topics chosen for both the sessions. Today, we are very happy to have eminent resource persons, especially Dr. Suresh, Assistant Professor of Statistics, University of Madras, Chennai, to share his wide knowledge about testing statistical hypotheses. So, on behalf of the management, I accord you a very warm welcome as you have spent your valuable time with us to share your knowledge with all the participants of our college.
Thank you.
I invoke God's blessings on you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
And on you, your family, and all your endeavors. I also take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Radhasekhar, who may be joining us in the next session, Associate Professor of Mathematics, Amita College of Engineering and Technology, who is going to speak about algebraic graph theory. I take this opportunity to congratulate and appreciate all the members of the Department of Mathematics aided, particularly convener Dr. Arifla Mehdi, the head of the department, the organizing secretaries, Dr. J.D.C. and Dr. Jesmala, for planning for all the arrangements made to realize this day. Dear participants, I wish each one of you a fruitful seminar. Once again, I invoke God's blessings and wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sister. Next, with great elation, I take this opportunity to invite our most respected resource person, Dr. S. Suresh, Assistant Professor of Statistics, University of Madras, Chennai, to lead the session on the topic Testing Statistical Hypothesis with Applications. Please, sir.
I hope the slide is visible. Am I audible? Anyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, very good morning to all. So I would like to thank especially Dr. Arul Flavor Mary Madam and her team given me an opportunity to deliver a talk in the national seminar organized by Department of Mathematics, Holy Cross College for Women. Thank you, Madam. Okay. Now I am going to discuss with you today testing statistical hypothesis with an examples. So statistics is a branch of mathematics. Okay. In the last 3 decades, in the modern world of computer and information technology, the statistics is very well recognized by all the disciplines. Nowadays, the people are saying like data science or data analytics. See, everything is gained from statistics only. If you see the data science syllabus or data analytics syllabus, so most of the subjects from statistics only. So only they are doing some programming language, then they call it as data science or data analytics. In India now, the most highest salary person is data science as well as actual science professionals. So our department is also offering actual science course. For your information, last year, two of your Holy Cross College students did their MSc actual science program in our department. So with this, I enter into the talk, testing statistical hypothesis. So before going to testing statistical hypothesis, I just briefly introduce the concept of statistics. Okay, so statistics is a science which deals with collection, classification, analyzing, and interpretation of a numerical data. So what do you mean by data? So data is a numerical value containing some information. And so collection of data, see what are the types of data? So first one is primary data, and the second one is, first one is primary data, which is collected by the investigator himself for the purpose of the study or inquiry. Say, for example, in your college, want to study the prevalence of obesity among the college students. So this is one simple example for primary data. So primary data, there are 4 or 5 methods are available for data collection. The first one is direct personal method, indirect oral method, scheduled questionnaire method, and so on. And the secondary data, those data have been already collected and used by some earlier agency for their use. The same data set we are used for our own purpose and find the solutions. Say, for example, the annual reports of a government agencies, Central Statistical Organization, or Times Reach data, and everything's under come from a secondary data. Okay, so now move to the next slide. Next one is after collecting the data, or that are called ungrouped data. So now the ungrouped data is always in a form of organized form and need to be organized and presented in a meaningful form to further facilitate a statistical further statistical analysis. So the process of grouping into different classes or subclasses according to some characteristic is known as classification. I say, for example, letter in the post office are classified according to their destinations like Delhi, Madurai, Bangalore, Mumbai. So once you have ungrouped data are always in a converted into organized form and presented in a meaningful form. Okay, there are two types of classification of data. So one is quantitative type of classification and qualitative type of classification. See, quantitative type of classification data can be classified, can be measured on a numerical value. Say, for example, the height, weight, student marks, these are all the example for quantitative type of data. And the quantitative classification of data can be classified according to some attributes or quality. Say, for example, sex, education qualification, income status. So these are all the example for qualitative type data. So why I mentioning this data? See, for once, suppose you are doing any statistical analysis, first you should familiar about the data type, whether your data type is a quantitative data or qualitative by data. According to, you have to choose the appropriate statistical tool. Say, for example, suppose you have a qualitative by data, or qualitative by data can also be called categorical data. See, categorical data mean that we cannot measure on a numerical value, but that can be classified according to some quality. Okay, say, for example, sex, education level, income status, eye color, okay, and so on. So now this type of data you have, it's only minimum statistical tools only you can apply. So for example, you can construct a frequency table or one-way classification table or high-score test for independence of attributes. So for example, I can give an example for qualitative data you have. Say, for example, you want to test there is any association between the smoking habit and lung cancer. So here, smoking habits, there are two categories. And lung cancer also, there are two categories. So both are is a qualitative data. Why I can say this is a qualitative data? See, smoking habit, there are two categories, either smoker or non-smoker. Lung cancer, present and not present. So here, is there any association between these two variables, smoking habits and lung cancer? So this type of data you have, you prefer high-score test. Okay, you prefer high-score test. Suppose you have a continuous type data, you can use almost all the statistical tools, begin with the descriptive statistics as well as inferential statistics. So with this, enter into testing a hypothesis. So statistics can be broadly classified into two types. So one is the descriptive statistics, another one is inferential statistics. So descriptive statistics, you might know that measures of central tendency, measures of dispersion, and correlation, regressions, the skewness, kurtosis, these measures are all under descriptive statistics. So inferential statistics is the other part. So inferential statistics can be broadly classified into two types. The one is estimation, another one is testing a hypothesis. Okay, so what do you mean by statistical inference? The statistical inference is nothing but is a drawing inference about the population through the sample information. Then immediately, in your mind, what is population and what is sample? See, population is nothing but is a group of items. Say, for example, total number of books in a library. Okay, this is one example for population. Or total number of houses in a city. Okay, total number of houses in a city. This is also an example for population. Then what do you mean by sample? Sample is nothing but is a fraction of total population or part of the total population. Okay, so the population is a group of items. See, and also you should know what is parameter. See, parameter is the characteristics of population. Okay, let's say, for example, the population mean, the population variance, population range, population standard deviation. These are all the parameters of characteristics of the population. Then sample. Okay, what do you mean by statistic? See, why I am highlighting these points. See, we are going to study or we are going to discuss a parametric test procedure like a testing for mean and testing for variance. So all the test statistics depends on the sample information only. So you must know what do you mean by parameter and what do you mean by statistic. So parameter is nothing but is the characteristic of a population. Sample is nothing but, statistic is nothing but is the function of sample observation. Say for example, sample mean, sample standard deviation, sample variance, these are all is called the statistic. So already I said statistical inference is drawing inference about the population through the sample information. Okay, so estimation and testing hypothesis. So in these lectures, I am going to discuss only testing a hypothesis, particularly parametric testing a hypothesis. So testing a hypothesis is broadly classified into two types. The one is parametric testing hypothesis, another one is non-parametric testing hypothesis. Then what is the, so you should know what is the difference between the parametric hypothesis and non-parametric hypothesis. See, parametric hypothesis mean that, say for example, one sample t-test, two sample t-test, paired t-test, analysis of variance. Suppose you have one data, you have one quantitative data, or suppose you have a height and weight of the data. Now you want to use parametric testing or non-parametric testing. You have to verify whether your data set satisfying the normality assumption or not. If your data set satisfying the normality assumption, then you prefer parametric test. Suppose your data set not satisfying the normality assumption, then you can go for non-parametric testing hypothesis. Okay, so this so next question arises in your mind, then how do we check the normality conditions? So that a lot of graphical procedures are available to check whether your data set satisfies the normality assumption, and also test statistics is also available to test whether the data set come from normal population. The test procedure often we use Shapiro-Wilk test. The Shapiro-Wilk test mainly used for testing the normality, whether your data set come from normal population or not. So most of the social science students and social science researcher, they do not worry about the they are not verifying the assumptions of normality. Then it will affect their output results or estimated results. Okay, so with this next concept is testing a hypothesis. So testing a hypothesis is some statement about the probability distribution characterizing a population on the basis of information available from the sample observations. So already I said statistical inference is drawing inference about the populations through the sample information. Okay, say for example, whether the crop yield has increased because of the new fertilizers. And another example I can give, whether the new medicine is effective in eliminating a particular disease. And the next one. Okay, so testing statistical hypothesis, the first step is define null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. So what do you mean by null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis? Null hypothesis is a hypothesis which is tested for possible rejection under the assumption that is true and usually denoted by H naught. See, null hypothesis always we define for possible rejection. Say for example, now you are going to test, the average height of the students in a mathematics department is around 155 centimeters. Okay, then you have to define null hypothesis. The average height of the mathematics student is not 150 centimeters. Okay, so we are always defining the null hypothesis is possible rejection. Okay, and now you see here, if you want to find out whether the special classes for college students after working hours has benefited to the students or not. Okay, this is one simple example. Now we shall set up a null hypothesis that H naught, the special classes after working hour not benefited for the students. So already I said, the null hypothesis always defined or always tested for possible rejection. Okay, so here special classes after working hour is not benefited to the students. Okay, now alternative hypothesis is the complementary of null hypothesis. Okay, for example, if you want to test a hypothesis, the population has a 1 minute. Is it visible?
Sir, Sir, your slide is not visible, sir.
Oh, sorry. Now, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Now, the alternative hypothesis is the complementary of a null hypothesis. Say, for example, if you want to test the null hypothesis, that is the population have a specified mean mu naught. Okay. So, null hypothesis is always we define H naught from mu is equal to mu naught. Then, alternative hypothesis may be H1 from mu not equal to mu naught, and H1 from mu greater than mu naught, and H1 from mu less than mu naught. So your alternative hypothesis, carefully you have to define it. It depends on the objective of your problem. So null hypothesis always we define H0 from mu is equal to mu naught. So here the null hypothesis we are defining for one sample t-test. Suppose you are testing the two sample t-test. So here you define the null hypothesis H0 from mu1 is equal to mu2. Okay. So here you have only one sample. Now you want to test or you want to specify the population mean, and also you have to define there is no significant difference between the assumed, sample mean as well as the population mean. You have to define the null hypothesis like this. Okay. Then the alternative hypothesis. Now you see here the alternative hypothesis, you have to choose any one of this type. The first one is the H1 from mu not equal to mu naught. Then what do you mean by mu not equal to mu naught? See, mu not equal to mu naught is known as a two-tailed test or two-sided test. Okay, but this, then when you may ask a question, when we use this type of alternative hypothesis, it depends on this. Say, for example, you want to claim that the average height of the students is not equal to 155. Okay, at that time, you have to choose first alternative hypothesis. Suppose you assume that the average height of the student is greater than 155 centimeter, then you have to choose a second one, H1 from mu is greater than mu naught. This is known as right tail test or one-sided hypothesis. Okay. And third one you see here, suppose H1 from mu is less than mu naught. So then now the average height of the student is less than 150 centimeter. Then this one is known as left tail test or one-sided test. Now you see here, the alternative hypothesis first is known as two-tail alternative or two-sided test. And alternative, the second one is known as right tail test or one-sided test. And the third one is known as left tail test or one-sided test. Now, next concept is level of significance. So level of significance is nothing but is the probability of committing type 1 error. Level of significance is denoted by alpha. See, normally we are fixing the two level of significance. One is 1% level of significance. Second one is 5% level of significance. So what do you mean by 1% level of significance or 5% level of significance? Mean that, say, there are 5 chances in 100 that we would be reject the hypothesis when it should be accepted. Is it clear? If, for example, the 5% level of significance is chosen in deriving a test of hypothesis, then there are 5 chances in 100 that we would be reject the hypothesis when it should be accepted. Okay, we are admitting 5% of the error. Okay, in our problem. Suppose it depends on the objective, or it depends on the data set only, you have to decide whether you have to fix a 5% level of significance or 1% level of significance. Maximum we fix 10% level of significance. So this is the following diagram illustrate the region in which we could accept or reject the null hypothesis when it is being tested at 5% level of significance. Now you see here, the accept the null hypothesis if the sample statistics falls in this region, the 95th in this region, okay, and reject the null hypothesis suppose the beyond this region. Now you see here this is the region, okay, then reject the null hypothesis either this one or that one. So what do you mean by critical region or critical value? So critical region is nothing but it's the test statistic value. So if you apply any testing procedure like one sample t-test or two sample t-test or paired t-test, see, final step is compare the calculated value on the table value. Table value is known as a critical value or critical region. Okay, the region is the sample space S, which amounts to rejection of H0 is termed as a critical region or rejection of region. Okay, the value of test statistic, which separates the critical region and the acceptance region, is called the critical value or significant value. It depends on the level of significance used under the alternative hypothesis, whether it is two-tail or one-tail. Now you see here, this is the graphical representation of the critical region. Here in this graph, having both the two tail and one tail. Suppose you are using the two tail, then you have to use the critical region alpha by 2. Suppose you are using the right tail, then using the alpha, digit alpha. Okay. So, and one more question you may, I mean, arise in your mind. So why we are using the normality condition only we are checking? See, in statistics, especially one concept you might know that, or you may study central limit theorem. So central limit theorem says that, see, any probability distribution is converged to normal when sample size is increased to n tends to infinity. So z is equal to x power minus mu divided by sigma divided by square root of n is converged to standard normal distribution follows now 0, 1 parameter. That's why only we assume that all the data set come from normal population, especially the testing the parametric test procedures. Now, see, already I said the one-tailed test or one-sided test. Okay, now you see here, for testing the mean of the population, the H naught from mu is equal to mu naught. Again, the alternative hypothesis, H1 from mu is greater than mu naught, right-tailed test, or H1 from mu is less than mu naught is left-tailed test. Okay, so mu is greater than mu naught mean that, say, same example I can give, the average height of the students is above 155 centimeter, then it is known as right-tailed test, okay, or below 150 centimeter, then it is known as left-tailed test, okay. Now this is the right tail test. How do we take a decision whether accept the hypothesis or reject the null hypothesis? Like that, left tail test. How do we take a decision whether accept the null hypothesis or reject the null hypothesis? The two tail test is also already discussed. Okay. Now I can give an example. You see here. Suppose there are two population brands of washing machines are manufactured by a standard process with mean warranty period is mu1. And other manufactured by a new technique with mean warranty period is mu2. Now, you see the next step you see here. Now, if we want to test if the washing machine differ significantly, then our null hypothesis is H0 from mu1 is equal to mu2 and the alternative will be mu1 from mu0 equal to mu2. Here, very important this one. Now, you see here the first line of this slide. If you want to test if the washing machine differs significantly, then our hypothesis is defined like this, H0 from mu1 is equal to mu2 versus H1 from mu0 equal to mu0, okay? Or, however, if you want to test whether the average warranty period produced by some new technique is more than those produced by the standard process, then we have H0 from mu1 is equal to mu2 and H1 from mu1 is less than mu2. So already I said, see here, how do we define our hypothesis? It depends on the objective of the problem. So previous first paragraph, we define two-sided null hypothesis. Second paragraph, you see here, if we want to test whether the average warranty period produced by some new technique is more than those produced by the standard process. So new technique is referenced for mu2 and the standard process is referenced for mu1. Therefore, we define the hypothesis H1 from mu1 is less than mu2. Okay, this is known as left tail test or one-sided test. Okay, so many researchers fail to define the alternative hypothesis. So this is the way you have to define the alternative hypothesis. Null hypothesis is more or less same. Null hypothesis, you are always define H0 from mu is equal to mu0 for one sample t-test. Two sample t-test only you have to define H0 from mu1 is equal to mu0. Okay, so I will give you an example at the time you understand if you have any doubt. Okay, now the next slide is test procedure. So you have to use any parametric test, you have to follow this 5-step. Okay, one sample t-test or two sample t-test or pair t-test or analysis of variance. You have to follow this 5-step procedure. What is the first step? Set up the null hypothesis. And the second one is set up the alternative hypothesis H1, so which is complementary to null hypothesis, which will include whether the one tail or two tail test is to be applied. Already I said, okay. And the third step, you have to choose appropriate level of significance. You have to fix 5% level of significance or 1% level of significance. And fourth one, see, calculate the test statistic. It is a general form. Z is equal to T minus expectation of t divided by standard error of t. See, expectation of t is nothing but mean, and standard error of t is nothing but standard deviation divided by square root of n or sigma divided by square root of n. And fifth step, see, compare the calculated value z and the critical value or table value. If the calculated value is greater than table value, we reject the null hypothesis at alpha level of significance. Otherwise, we do not reject the null hypothesis. So keep in your mind these five steps. If you are using any test procedure, especially the parametric test procedure, one sample t-test or two sample t-test or paired t-test, ANOVA, you should follow these five steps. First, you have to define the null hypothesis, and you have to define the alternative, and you have to define the level of significance alpha, and define test statistic, and you have to compare the calculated value and the table value. If the calculated value is greater than table value, we reject the null hypothesis. Otherwise, do not reject the null hypothesis. Okay, now come to see one sample t-test. See, already I said at the beginning of this lecture, testing of statistical hypothesis is broadly classified into two types. One is parametric test and another one is non-parametric test. So parametric test satisfying some assumptions. Now see that suppose you are going to use one sample t-test for your data set. Suppose you have only one sample. Say for example, you want to study about the average weight of the mathematics department students in your college. Okay, so you have to collect the sample from the sample from your college mathematics department. Either sample size will be 25 or 30. Okay, after that you have to check the assumption. The first assumption is verify whether the parent population come from normal or not. Okay, the parent population come from normal. And the second one is the sample observations are random and independent. And the third one is the population standard deviation is not known. The population standard deviation is known, then you have to use the test statistic Z is equal to x bar minus mu divided by sigma divided by square root of n. Normally, the real-time data, the population standard deviation is not known. So we are always use the test statistic is x bar minus mu divided by s divided by square root of n follows student distribution with the n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Okay, now you see here, this is the step-by-step procedure for one sample t-test. Okay, now first step you see here, h naught from mu is equal to mu naught. The meaning is, there is no significant difference between the sample mean and the population mean. Okay, now here we are going to test only one group of data. Okay, so why I say only one group of data? Here we are using only h naught from mu is equal to mu naught. Suppose here we define h naught from mu 1 is equal to mu 2, then so you have to define null hypothesis h naught from mu 1 is equal to mu 2. Okay, but here you have to assign the value for mu naught. So you just remember the example already I discussed. Say for example, the average weight of the students in your class around 45 kilogram. Okay, then instead of mu naught, you have to fix the value h naught from mu is equal to 45. And alternative hypothesis, you claim that the average weight of the college student is greater than 45, then you have to use the right tail test. Or the average weight of the students in the math department or college students is less than 45, then you have to use left tail test. Okay, it depends on the objective of the problem. Okay, now you see here, the first step, already I said any testing procedure, you should follow these steps. The first one is define the null hypothesis. Now second one you see here, okay, in this example, we are going to test H1 from mu not equal to mu naught, two-sided. Or suppose H1 from mu greater than mu naught, one-sided, right tail. Or H1 from mu less than mu naught, left tail. Okay, this is also one tail. And the third step, define the level of significance, 5% or either 5% or 1%. And the fourth step, define the test statistic. T is equal to absolute value of x bar minus mu divided by s divided by square root of n, where x bar is the sample mean. See, already you know that x bar is equal to 1 divided by n sum of xi. I ranges from 1 to n. Okay. And s square is equal to 1 divided by n minus 1 sum of xi minus x bar whole square. Okay. So now see here, the test statistic is x bar minus mu divided by s divided by square root of n. Now you just now I remember the definition of statistical inference also. So statistical inference is drawing inference about the population through the sample. So here we are going to test the population mean. So mu naught is the population mean. But now you see here we are collecting the sample. So we are drawing the inference about the population through the sample is known as the statistical inference. So you should understand here x bar is the sample mean or statistic, s square is also a statistic. Now using this s square and s bar, these are the function of sample observations. Now, using the sample information, we are going to give an inference about the population. Here, mu is the sample mean and mu naught is the population mean. I hope you understand. See, if you have any doubt, feel free to ask. Okay. So now, the fifth step you see here, if the test statistic value is greater than the critical value or a table value, the null hypothesis may be rejected at the given level of significance. Otherwise, do not reject the null hypothesis. Okay. So now, now you see here, I can give an example. You see here, certain pesticide is packed into the bags by a machine. So a random sample of 10 bags is drawn and their content are found to be weight as follows. Assume that the data set come from normal population. Here, assume that the data set come from normal population, then no need to check. Okay. And you see here, the question is, test if the average packing can be taken to be a 50 kilogram. Okay. So now in this type of example, how do we define the null hypothesis? Here, whether we choose the one tail alternative or two tail alternative. See here, this is the question. Average packing can be taken to be 50 kilogram. Okay. So here you have to choose two-sided test. Why? The average packing can be taken to be 50 exact value. Suppose here the question is should be like this. The average packing can be greater than 50 kilogram. Then you have to choose here. You have to choose here H1 is greater than 50 kilogram. Or the average packing can be taken is less than 50 kilogram. Then you have to choose left tail test. Okay. So it depends on the objective of your problem only. You have to choose the alternative hypothesis, whether one-sided or two-sided. Okay. Now, from the sample information, now we are going to define the null hypothesis in this problem. H naught from mu is equal to 50 and H1 from mu not equal to 50. So why we are defining the two-sided test? Here the test, the average packing can be taken to be 50 kilogram or not equal to 50 kilogram. So we define here two-sided hypothesis or two-sided alternative hypothesis. Next, we define in this problem, we define the level of significance alpha is equal to 0.05%. Okay. And the test statistic t is equal to x power minus mu divided by smallest divided by square root of n follows student distribution with n degrees of freedom. So here why we are using 10 minus 1 because the sample observations are 10. So n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So 10 minus 1, 9 degrees of freedom. So the table value, this is the value is obtained from using this test statistic x bar minus mu divided by s divided by square root of n t is equal to 3.20. And the table value, choose the table value from the student table at 5% level. Okay, the student table value is 2.62. Now we draw inference. Since the test statistic value is greater than the critical value at 5% level of significance, so we conclude that we reject the null hypothesis and the average packing cannot be taken to be a 50 kilogram. This is what our inference. Okay. This is what our inference. So here, once again, I repeat, this is very, very important. So many students fail to define the alternative hypothesis and drawing inference. Also, many researchers fail to write. Okay. So here, alternative hypothesis depends on the problem. Here, average packing can be to be a 50 kilogram or not equal to 50 kilogram. Therefore, we are using two-tail test. And also the inference here, test statistic value greater than the critical value at 5% level of significance. And we conclude that the average packing cannot to be taken to be a 50 kilogram. Okay. So now next slide. Now I can give another example also. Now you see here, the following data gives the hemoglobin level in a group of 15 women students studying in a college. Test whether the hemoglobin level in the young woman is significantly lower than the average level of 13 centimeter. Now you see here, so what is the difference between the previous example and this example? This example, you have to define the alternative hypothesis See here, the alternate hypothesis only I will explain here. Test whether the hemoglobin level in the young woman is significantly lower than the average level of 13 grams. Okay, so here you have to define the alternative hypothesis is mu is less than 13. So previous example you have defined H1 from mu not equal to 50. So mu1 not equal to 50. But here in this example we define H1 from mu is less than 15, less than 13. So why I am highlighting this one? So here we are using leptile test or one-sided test. So why we are using one-sided alternative? Here we are test whether the hemoglobin level in the young woman significantly lower than the average level of 13 gram. Okay, so expected for woman population. So now you see we define the hypothesis. You see here the H naught, the hemoglobin level in woman studying in a college do not differ significantly from the hemoglobin level of 13% of woman population. Okay, so now the next slide. See, actually this is the output taken from using SPSS software. So SPSS stand for Statistical Package for Social Science. Once you feed the data, immediately fraction of second you will get output. But you should know how to interpret the values from getting the output from SPSS. Now you see here, from this output, here the t value is 8.66. So already I said the t value is absolute value. So suppose you get a negative value, you assume that it's a positive value. So output gives a t value and the degrees of freedom is 14. So here the 15 women students are we consider. So n minus 1, 14 degrees of freedom. And the significant level is 95% of confidence interval because we admit 5% level of significance. So here the test statistic value is 8.657 for 14 degrees of freedom is highly significant, as the significant value is 0.000. And one more important step is if you have a data set, suppose you are using any statistical software like SPSS or R or Python or MS Excel, all the softwares give a p value only. See, p value is nothing but it's a probability of committing type 1 error value. If the p value is less than 0.05, significant, otherwise do not significance. In this example, the p value is less than 0.05, therefore we reject the null hypothesis and we accept the alternative hypothesis. So our conclusion is, we reject the null hypothesis and infer that the hemoglobin level in the young woman is significantly lower than the average level of 13 gram expected for woman population. This is what our inference from one sample t-test. Okay. Now, hypothesis concerning the variance. See, already the hypothesis parametric test, we are testing for proportion and testing for mean and testing for variance. Okay. See, testing for mean follows the student distribution, one sample and two sample. Okay. And suppose testing for suppose you are going to compare testing for more than two sample mean, then you have to go for analysis of variance one way. Then concerning the variance. Suppose testing for one sample variance, it follows a high score distribution. Testing for two sample variance, it follows the F distribution. Okay, now you see here the rest of the steps are similar. So only I will kind of highlight the example. The horse longevity data is given below. To test the significant difference between the variance and hypothesis variance of sigma naught square is equal to 22 years. So previous example, we defined H naught from mu is equal to mu naught. Here you see here we define H naught from mean sigma is equal to sigma naught square. Either you have to test based on the mean or test based on the variance. It depends on the problem only. So here, suppose you are testing the mean, you have to define the hypothesis H naught from mu is equal to mu naught. Or testing the variance, you have to define the hypothesis is H naught from sigma naught, sigma is equal to sigma naught, sigma square is equal to sigma naught square. Now age at death, the 25 horses lifetime data is given here. So here the H naught is, there is no significant difference between the variance and hypothesis variance. and H1 is there is a significant difference between the variance and hypothesis variance. So here also we are using the two-sided test, because you see here, to test the significant difference between the variance and hypothesis variance, sigma naught square. Okay, suppose to test the significant difference between the variance is greater than the hypothesis variance, then you have to use the right tail test, or less than the hypothesis variance, then you have to use the left tail test. Now this is the test statistic for testing the one sample variance. So the test statistics follows high square distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom, and the test statistic is n minus 1 s square divided by sigma naught square. Sigma naught square is the hypothesis variance and s square is the sample variance, and n minus 1 means that it's the total number of observation minus 1. In this example, after calculating the value, the test statistics value is 43.293 and the table value is 39.364. Okay, so now inference is same for all the test procedure. If the calculated value is greater than the table value, so we reject the null hypothesis. Otherwise, do not reject the null hypothesis. So in this example, so we reject the null hypothesis because the 43.293 is greater than 39.364 at 5% level of significance. Okay, now two sample t test. See, one sample, now see here. Suppose we want to test if the two independent samples have been drawn from two normal population having the same mean, the population variance being equal. Okay, so let x1 comma x2 up to xn and y1 comma y2 up to ym be two independent random samples from a given normal population. So how these are the step-by-step procedure. I can give an example. I'm always using that example, simple example. Suppose you want to test the average height of the students in a classroom, male student and female student. The average height of the male student is significantly different from the female students. Now you want to test. Okay, then you have to define the hypothesis H0 from mu 1 is equal to mu 2, where mu 1 is the average height of the male student and mu 2 is the average height of the female student. These two groups are independent groups. Male students are independent and female students are independent. This type of example, you can go for a two sample t test. Okay, so now the first step is H0 from mu 1 is equal to mu 2, and the second step is alternative hypothesis. You define H1 from mu 1 is not equal to mu 2, two-sided, or mu 1 is greater than mu 2, one-sided, right tail, or mu 1 is less than mu 2, one-sided, left tail. Okay, now you see the test statistic here, x bar minus y bar divided by square root of s square into 1 divided by n1 plus 1 divided by n2 follows student distribution with n1 plus n2 minus 2 degrees of freedom. Okay, where s square is equal to 1 divided by n1 plus n2 minus 2 sum of x minus x bar whole square plus sum of y minus y bar whole square. You may have studied here in this example, s square is known as pooled variance. Okay, so this can also be written as s square is equal to n into s1 plus n1 s1 plus n2 s2. So n1 s1 mean that, see, s1 is equal to 1 divided by n1 minus 1 divided by n1 into sum of xi minus x bar, s2 is equal to 1 divided by n2 sum of yi minus y bar whole square. The inference is saying if the test statistic value is greater than the critical value, then the null hypothesis may be rejected at the given level of significance. Otherwise, we do not reject the null hypothesis. Okay, now see here the example for two sample t test. Okay, the data is related to the time it takes to blood to clot as measured for each of 13 persons, 6 given one kind of drug and 7 given another kind of drug, to test whether the blood of person treated with drug B has the same mean clotting time as a person treated with the drug G. Okay, so in this example, so immediately in your mind, okay, what type of alternative hypothesis we have to choose. Here you see here to test whether blood of person treated with the drug B has the same mean clotting time as does from person treated with the drug C. So here we are defining the alternative hypothesis two-sided. Okay, now see H0 from mu 1 is equal to mu 2 against H1 from mu 1 not equal to mu 2. Okay, so level of significance is 5% or 1%, and that is, this is the test statistic value. After calculating the test statistic and the table value is 2.201. So in these examples also, we reject the null hypothesis. So our inference is here, there is a significant difference between the blood pressing there is a significant difference between the person, 6 person giving their own kind of track and 7 person giving their another kind of track. Okay, there is a significant difference. And another example also I can give for 2 sample k-tests. Okay, the 2 group of children were fed on 2 different diets, namely diet A and diet B. So the level of hemoglobin in blood were estimated and presented in the below table. Okay, test the superiority of diet A over diet B over diet A in increasing the hemoglobin level. Now you see here in this example whether we can go for one-sided alternative hypothesis or two-sided alternative hypothesis. See, in this example we can go for one-sided hypothesis. Why one-sided hypothesis? Test the superiority of diet B over diet A. So here, and also immediately in your mind arises some question whether we use right tail test or left tail test. So here in this example, diet superiority of diet B over diet A. So here here you suppose you assume that mu 1 is equal to A or mu 2 is equal to B. So you have to defend the hypothesis H1 from mu is less than mu 1 is less than mu 2. Okay, it depends on the sample only. Suppose you are defining diet A mean is mu 1 and diet B mean is mu 2. So here you are using H1 from mu 1 less than mu 2. Okay, because diet B is superior than diet A. So this is the output taken from SPSS software. So here the T value is 1.239 for 26 degrees of freedom. And here the significant value is now, here the significant value is 0.226. 0.226 means that the P value is greater than 0.05. Therefore, we do not reject the null hypothesis. So far, you have seen more than 3 or 4 examples. All the examples, we reject the null hypothesis. The first time in this example only, you have seen in this example only the p value is greater than 0.05, so we accept the null hypothesis. Then our inference is diet B is not superior to diet A in increasing the hemoglobin level. This is what our inference. Okay, so if the p value is less than 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis. If the p value is greater than 0.05, we do not reject the null hypothesis. Either you have to draw inference using the compare the calculated value and the table value. Otherwise, suppose you are using any software packages, you are using instead of comparing calculated and table value, you have to take in the significant value. Okay, the next one is what is PAT t-test. So PAT t-test is also known as dependent t-test or related samples. Okay, so in the t-test for a difference of means, the 2 samples were independent of each other. Let us now a particular situation where the samples are equal, but we are giving the 2 different treatments. Okay, so for example, you see here a business concern want to find if a particular media of promoting a sales of a product, say door-to-door canvassing or advertisement in a paper or through TV, is really effective or not. Similarly, a pharma company want to test the efficacy of a particular drug, say for inducing the sleep after the drug is given. Or I can give another example also, simple example. Suppose I want to test the student's IQ level before giving the training and after giving the training, whether the training is effective or not. This type of example, the group is same. Okay, the group is same, the sample group is same, but we are giving the 2 different treatments. Before giving the training, you have to test the IQ level of the student. And after giving a training, you have to measure the IQ level of the student. Now you have to test whether the training program is effective or not. This type of examples, you have to go for PAT t-test or dependent t-test. Okay, now the same. See, only difference is here. You see here the test statistic, the rest of the steps are same. The test statistic T is equal to T bar divided by S divided by square root of N. So then immediately you may have a doubt. What do you mean by D bar? So D bar is nothing but X1 bar minus X2 bar. See, X1 bar is represented for the sample before giving a treatment or before giving a training, and X2 bar after giving a training. And SD, see, actually here the typographical error, see here SD. SD means the standard deviation of the differenced value. Square root of N is the number of observations. Okay, the same inference only here we have to follow. Now see that the example for PAT t-test. To evaluate the efficacy of the supplementary diet in increasing the hemoglobin. Okay, to evaluate the efficiency of the supplementary diet in increasing the hemoglobin level, So before giving a treatment and after giving a treatment, we are measuring the hemoglobin level. Okay, now hypothesis, now the null hypothesis, the supplementary diet is not effective in increasing the hemoglobin level in human. Okay, and you see here the example number 2, an IQ test was administered to 5 students before and after they were trained. So the results shown below. So IQ before training and after training, test whether there is any change in IQ after the training program. Okay, so this type of data set, this type of data you have, you can prefer PATI test. This is the output are same. Okay, next one is analysis of variance. See, analysis of variance, okay, when we go for analysis of variance, so for suppose independent sample t-test, suppose you have only 2 group, now you want to compare the 2 group mean are equal, then you can go for independent sample t-test. Now suppose you have more than 2 group, see more than 2 group, you have to test all the, suppose you have a k group or you have a 4 group, now you want to test all the 4 group means are equal, then you can go for analysis of variance. For example, you see here, 5 fertilizers are applied to 4 plots, each of wheat and each of and the yield of wheat on each of the plot is given. So we may be interested in finding out whether the effect of these fertilizers on the yield is significantly different, or in other words, whether the sample have come from the same normal population or not. So here the question is, you see here, the 5 fertilizers are applied to 4 plots, each of the wheat and the yield of the wheat on each of the plot is given. Okay, so here 5 fertilizers are applied to 4 plot, okay, in each of the wheat and yield of the wheat. Okay, now whether all the 5 fertilizers giving the same yield or having the difference, or is the significant difference. Okay, suppose you want to compare any 2 of these 5 fertilizers yield, then go for independent sample, or you have to test all the 5 fertilizers giving the same yield, your hypothesis defining like that, you can go for analysis of variance one way. Now you see the assumptions here, the observations are independent, the parent population come from normal, and various treatments and environmental effects are additive in nature, and we assume that the population variance are equal. Okay, now the steps are involved in analysis of variance. Okay, now you see here, previous examples we define only h naught from mu 1 is equal to mu 2. Now you see here, h naught from mu 1 is equal to mu 2 is equal to up to mu k. So suppose you have a k group, now you want to test all the k group means are equal, then you can go for analysis of variance. And how do we define the alternative hypothesis? The alternative hypothesis here, full always using the two-sided hypothesis, you have to define at least 2 population means are not equal. At least 2 population means are not equal. And the level of significance and the test statistic is here. Here we are going to create an ANOVA table. So we can't directly, we can write, suppose one sample t-test you can apply. So you have to write the test statistic is small t is equal to x bar minus mu divided by s divided by square root of n follows student distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Here we can't directly write as test statistics. So we are going to create ANOVA table. So ANOVA table consists of a 5 column. The first one is sources of variation, degrees of freedom, sum of square, mean sum of square, and F value. Okay, I hope the students who have already studied in our program, UG program. Okay, anyway, I will explain quickly. Okay, now see here. Okay, previous slide. Now you see here, what is CF? CF is nothing but it's a correction factor is equal to G square divided by N. G square is nothing but grand total. Grand total. I will give you an example at the time, understand. N is the total number of observation. Now you see here, the first step, you have to find out the TSS. TSS is nothing but total sum of square. The total sum of square is mean that sum of the square of the individual observation minus correction factor. Okay, total sum of square. And the next one is SST is nothing but the treatment sum of square. The treatment sum of square means that sum of the each treatment divided by corresponding the sample size minus correction factor. Okay, so TA square means, suppose previous example is assume that, so we are using the 5 fertilizers. We are using the 5 fertilizer in a plot. Okay, we are getting the yield for in the wheat. Okay, we yield of wheat we are getting. Now, so this, if suppose the first fertilizer we are applying in 4 plots, second fertilizer we are applying the 5 plots, third fertilizer we are applying the 6 plots, sample sizes may be equal for each treatment or may not be equal for one-way analysis of variance. So you are calculating the sum of the treatment. The formula is sum of I is equal to 1 to k TA squared divided by NI minus CF. Okay, and what is SSE? SSE is nothing but the error sum of square. Error sum of square is equal to total sum of square minus sum of square treatment. Okay. Now, here is the degrees of freedom. Okay. Degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom means that suppose you are using the four treatment or you have a four group. So, treatment degrees of freedom is 4 minus 1. Suppose you have total number of observation minus 1 is known as total degrees of freedom. So, error degrees of freedom is equal to total degrees of freedom minus treatment degrees of freedom. Okay. Now, I will show you the table. Okay. Now, so this is the ANOVA table. Now, you see here. Wait. Now, you see here. This is the k minus 1. Okay, this is the n minus k and the n minus 1. That is very, very important. So, here the total degrees of freedom mean that total number of observation minus 1, n minus 1. Treatment degrees of freedom mean that suppose you are using 5 fertilizers or 5 treatments or 5 population group. So, 5 minus 1, 4. Now, you want to find out the error degrees of freedom. So, total minus treatment, you get the error degrees of freedom. Now, you see here, next step, sum of square. Sum of square treatment means that the each treatment sum of square divided by respective sample size. Okay, already the previous slide you have seen the formula for treatment sum of square and the total sum of square also you have seen. Now, sum of square error is equal to total sum of square minus sum of square treatment. Now, how can we calculate the mean sum of square treatment and mean sum of square error? Mean sum of square treatment is equal to sum of square treatment divided by respective degrees of freedom. Mean sum of square error is equal to sum of square error divided by respective degrees of freedom. And what is F value? F value is nothing but mean square sum of square treatment divided by mean sum of square error. Okay. And one more doubt, how do we calculate the table value? So table value, you have to see the treatment degrees of freedom and error degrees of freedom from the F table at 5% level of significance or 1% level of significance. Okay. So now you see here K minus 1 comma N minus K. K minus 1 is the treatment degrees of freedom and N minus K is the error degrees of freedom. So inference is similar. If the calculated F value is less than the table F value, we accept our null hypothesis. If the calculated F value is greater than the table value, we reject the null hypothesis. Okay. Sorry. Sorry. Okay. I think I can give another example. Now you see here. 5 new varieties of rice were cultivated in different homogeneous plot in an agriculture research station. The production data of different varieties of rice shown below. Now you see here, the 5 rice variety data is available. Now test here, average production of rice varieties are same or not. Average production of rice varieties are same or not. Okay. So now, suppose you have to use the independent sample t-test, you have to compare only 2 group sample mean. Now here we have a 5 group. So how can we test all the 5 group means are equal, then go for analysis of the variance. Okay. Now see here, 5 new varieties of rice are cultivated in different homogeneous plot in an agriculture research station. So the production data of different varieties of rice shown below, the 5 varieties. Okay, the null hypothesis is average production of rice varieties are same. So alternate hypothesis is at least 2 production is not same. Okay. You can use any statistical software, you can get the test statistics, F value. See, F value, so many students have failed to write inference F value for F. Once you see the F value, immediately they claim that F is the variance, we are testing the variance. It's not like that. So here we are testing the mean only, but we are using the F tests. Okay. But F test only for analysis of variance, we are not testing the variance. We are testing the mean for more than 2 sample. Okay, more than 2 sample. So F value test for mean for 2 population only for analysis of variance concept. Now the last one, the high square test. So already in the beginning of my lecture, I told you, so when you have a qualitative type data, you can go for high square test. When you have a quantitative type data, you have used either 1 sample t-test or 2 sample t-test or PAT t-test or analysis of variance. Okay, so now this is the high square test for independence is a test to find out whether the 2 categorical variables are associated with each other or not. Okay, these are the step-by-step procedure for a high square test. So write the null and alternative hypothesis. So null hypothesis, there is no relationship between the variable, and alternative hypothesis is there is a relationship between the variable. And step 2, That is very, very important. Suppose you are using the high-score test, suppose you have one data set, suppose you want both the data sets are qualitative in nature, then you are using a high-score test, you have to check after getting the output, at least 80% of expected count should be greater than 5. At least 80% of expected count should be greater than 5. Otherwise, don't take the high-score test statistic value. At the time, you have to take Fisher-XR test value. Okay, so what do you mean by at least 80% of expected count should be greater than 5? Mean that suppose some of the value expected count is less than 4, less than 5, then you have to pool that value. You may have studied in the distribution theory, testing a goodness of fit, fitting a Poisson distribution or fitting a binomial distribution. Suppose the expected count value is 4 or 3, you pool the value. Okay, so in the software may not do that. Then instead of using high-score test statistics value, you consider Fisher-XR test value. Now this is the test statistic, high-score test for goodness, high-score test for independence. Observed frequency minus expected frequency whole square divided by expected frequency. Now I will give an example. A group of students were classified in terms of gender and blood group. So find out whether there is an association between the gender and blood group. Now you see here, blood group, there are 4 categories. Sex, there are 2 categories. Now we are going to test, there is no association between gender and blood group. And alternate hypothesis is, there is an association between the gender and blood group. Okay, now you see here, sex is the qualitative data and the blood group is also qualitative. So blood group, out of 200 respondents, so here 100 are male and 100 are female. Out of 100 male, 28 respondent belonging to the blood group A and 16 respondent belonging to B and 7 respondent belonging to AB and 49 respondent belonging to O positive, O good blood group. Okay, like that the female also classified. This type of data you have, how do we test? Is there any association between the blood group and sex? You can go for high-score test statistics. Okay, now you see here, the high-score test statistic using the statistical software, SPSS, I got output Pearson high-score test. Now you see here, the Pearson high-score test statistics value is 0.79. And here, the significant value is 0.8385. And one more important note is here, how do we calculate the degrees of freedom? So here, high-score test statistic degrees of freedom is also, many researchers failed to find out the degrees of freedom. Say, suppose you are using testing for mean or testing of variance. For example, testing for mean one sample, you know that the test statistic follows student distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Suppose you have a 10 observation, degrees of freedom is 9. But high-score test, how many rows you have used and how many columns you have used. Suppose in this example, you have used sex is a 2 category and the blood group is a 4 category. So 2 minus 1 into 4 minus 1. So 2 minus 1, 1, 4 minus 1, 3. So 3 degrees of freedom here. Now see here, 3 degrees of freedom you have. Okay, so like that you have to calculate the degrees of freedom. Now see here the significant value is 0.85. So p value is greater than 0.05. Then we conclude that there is no association between the sex and blood group in this example. I can give another example also. A group of students of university have been classified according to the academic performance measured by grade obtained in examination and by discipline. Okay, the number of students of different groups are shown below. Now see here, grade and discipline. Now are grade associated with the discipline? So this type of data you have. Now the same. So now here in this example, so what is the degrees of freedom? Okay, in this example, the degrees of freedom is grade, there are 4 category, and discipline, there are 3 categories. So 4 minus 1, 3, 3 minus 1, 2. So 3 into 2, 6 degrees of freedom. Okay, so here, suppose the p-value is less than 0.05, so we reject the null hypothesis, then there is an association between the grades with the discipline. Suppose the p-value is greater than 0.05, there is no association between the grades and discipline. The testing for two variants. So testing for two variants follows the F distribution. The F distribution, F test statistic is equal to sigma 1 squared divided by N1 whole divided by sigma 2 squared divided by N2 follows F distribution with N1 comma N2 degrees of freedom. Okay, I think with this, I conclude my lecture. So if you have any questions, you may ask now. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, sir. That was a really informative and a useful session. People say gratitude is the mother of all virtues. May I now call upon Kritika K of Planetary Mathematics to deliver her vote of thanks.
Give thanks in all circumstances, says the Holy Bible. On this wonderful day, it gives me immense pleasure to give my application in the form of prayer. First, I would like to thank Lord Almighty, Raja, and the Lord and God. Next, I express my gratitude to our most trusted principal, Dr. Annie Gobert Sophie. Next, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to the pillar of our department, our beloved HOD, Dr. Arifla Mary, who generously helped us to make this event come together. Thank you, ma'am. Next, we are grateful to our resource person, Dr. S. Ramesh, Assistant Professor of Statistics, University of Madras, Chennai. Thank you, sir. Your talk on testing hypothesis was very informative, and I can certainly say that at least some of us take the statistics in our PG program. Thank you, sir. Plant without water and sunlight cannot turn into water. Likewise, this program would not have been successful without the constant support of our beloved teachers, Dr. Jayade Singh and Dr. Sismar. Thank you, ma'am. I also express my heartfelt gratitude to all the faculty who have participated in this event for guiding us for the work. Thank you all. Finally, I also extend my thanks to superstars of the department who made this event with their active participation. Thank you, buddies, for your attention.